Vishnu, we are live now. You can please start the session now.
Hello, I am audible there?
Yeah, please start the session.
Hello, namaste and good afternoon. This is Vishnu Thakur, optom student from NAMS Bir Hospital, Kathmandu, and we'll hosting today's session. On the behalf of optom, I would like to welcome to all today participants on this session. A brief introduction to about our program here. E-learning session is an interactive by for optom, and it is an interactive program where we discuss about optometric topic. So today we have with us Dr. Vikram Bahadur Thapa. First of all, introduction. Dr. Vikram Bahadur Thapa completed Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery MBBS from BPKIHS Dharan and graduate in the year 2011. He also completed his post-graduation MD ophthalmology from PGIMER Chandigarh in the year 2014. He also holds fellowship in neuro-ophthalmology from Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai in the year 2018 and fellowship in vitreoretinal surgery from Lumini Eye Institute and Research Center, Bhairava in the year 2020. Dr. Vikram Bahadur Thapa also has a working experience of general ophthalmologist at Geta Eye Hospital, Dhangadi and Nepal Red Cross Society, Surkhet. Since last 4 years, he is working as an assistant professor at Nepalganj Medical College. He also has published several papers in national and international journal. He also presented several oral and poster presentations in several national and international conferences. Today, he will be taking the session on topic about ocular myasthenia gravis. Before we start, I would like to request to all, if there is any question, inquiries, and put it on the comment box below. At the end of the presentation, he will answer this all your questions and queries. Okay, sir, I feel proud and honored to welcome you.
Thank you, Vishnu. We'll and all the e-learning team. Today, I will be talking a little bit about this ocular myasthenia gravis, which is not much common and not much commonly talking and seeing subject in our sessions. And today we'll learn little bit what we must know, what we must do for this patient, what we should not miss, that is the important while dealing with the patient of ptosis and ocular motility disorder. So we'll be just talking part that lies on the ocular myasthenia gravis. Okay, so I have no financial disclosure material and objective of today's learning session are only we should able to detect the and prevent the disasters, to know the drugs needed to avoid in this patient. Some of the drug, if we use in this patient, they can take their life. So that to highlight in this small lecture. So with introduction, the term myasthenia gravis was brought from Greek and Latin word. There are three words. Mys is the muscle in Greek. Asthenia is the weakness. And Latin word gravis means very serious. So on the literal meaning, myasthenia gravis is a serious disorder of muscle with muscle weakness. So presently, we define it as a chronic progressive autoimmune disease involving neuromuscular junction, NMJ, of skeletal muscle, not of the cardiac and the smooth muscle, thus resulting in the variable weakness. We should know the variable term, changing, okay, not the constant, and easy fatigability of skeletal muscle. So this is the present definition of myasthenia gravis. This is the most common primary disorder of neuromuscular junction. Though it's not much common, if we go to the neuromuscular junction disorder, it is the most common primary disorder. Thomas Willis, Samuel Weil, along with Ebb and Goldflam were the first people who described about the myasthenia gravis before 17th century. And the first time it was termed as myasthenia gravis or pseudo-paralytica, means not a paralysis, but it's pseudo-paralysis by German scientist Jolie in 1895. Till that time, there was no treatment of this disorder, and this disorder was ultimately making people disable and finally kill them. So it was a grave disease in that way. But the young scientist, young doctor Mary Walker, made it possible, treatment of this disorder possible in 1934, being our master's in University of Edinburgh, for which she received the gold medal from that university, and later on she get Jean Hunter Prize in 1962. So the person that find out the treatment of this grave disease was a student, not a teacher. Okay, then after this brief introduction, we will enter into the pathophysiology. I will not go in detail in this part also. So first thing, what is the neuromuscular junction that we should know in physiology? If you see this photo, there are two structures. One is the yellowish one is the nerve, and the reddish one is the muscle infiltrate. So in between there is a gap. So this gap, along with these two structures, constitute the neuromuscular junction. The nerve here act as a source of motor impulse from the central nervous system, which stimulate the nerve muscle to contract. So that is the normal physiology. And this, once the action potential to activate this muscle comes through this nerve, there will be release of presynaptic vesicle, and there will be release of acetylcholine from this ruptured presynaptic vesicle into the neuromuscular junction. Then this acetylcholine, which is a neurotransmitter receptor, which you can see on the muscle in plate, these are called acetylcholine receptor. And these acetylcholine attack ions, and that lead to the formation of in plate potential. That is, this electrical energy over this membrane of the motor in plate, if that cross the threshold, then that to the action potential and contraction of ions. In this disorder, the basic defect or pathology in this disorder is the presence of N,N-acetylcholine receptor. How does they form? What happens generally in investigation, what we get is around in 99% of generalized myasthenia gravis and around 40 to 80% of ocular myasthenia gravis, we can detect this antibody in serum. So what happens in the pathophysiology is our T cell, our immune system, some defect happen in our immune system, and the T lymphocyte will recognize normal acetylcholine receptor as a foreign body, not of us. Once that stimulation occurred, then these T cell stimulate the B cell to produce the antibody against this foreign particle, foreign protein. just like that, if we inject the vaccine containing this microbial agent, what happens is our B cell start to form the antibody against that antigen or that material in the vaccine. Same thing happen over here, though these acetylcholine receptors are not foreign body, but they falsely recognize them as a foreign body. Okay, then antibody, once they form, they will attach to this acetylcholine receptor where normally acetylcholine was attaching and block them. Then there will not be formation of threshold in plate potential that results in the inability to contract the muscle fiber. That what happens in this disorder. Okay, so you can see there are antibody which bind to the motor in plate acetylcholine receptor, and there is no place in these receptor to bind with the acetylcholine. So these acetylcholine and antibody against acetylcholine receptor will compete to bind this receptor. So there will be competition, and if the available antibody are more than that of acetylcholine, then antibody will bind and action potential will not generate. If there is lots of acetylcholine in the neuromuscular junction and less antibody, then there will be formation of these antibody will not less binding of the antibody will be there, and this acetylcholine will bind to more receptor, resulting in the formation of this action potential. So this explains the variable weakness. If there is higher concentration of acetylcholine, muscle will contract nicely. If there is lesser concentration of acetylcholine, then muscle will be weak and they will not able to contract because of this competitive nature of these two protein. On epidemiological aspect, myasthenia gravis affect almost 50 to 200 per million people in the world. It is newly diagnosed in 3 to 30 per million people in each year. It most commonly occurs in women under 40. With the available treatment, which was from Mary Walker, most of myasthenia cases lead relatively normal life if they take treatment, not other way, and have the normal life expectancy if they get treatment. These are the two terms. If we give them treatment, that means the patient will not be in grave disease. So gravis term can be removed if they got treatment. A clinical feature, the main and most common symptom of this disease is painless weakness of specific muscle, not fatigue. But fatigability is their symptom. It happened there, but most common and main symptom is only weakness of specific muscle. This weakness is progressively worse on physical activity and improve after rest. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir. Please,
yeah, please. Okay. Typically, the weakness and fatigue are worse toward the end of day. Myasthenia gravis start with ocular weakness. Generally, it start with ocular muscle, mainly the LPS, and then progress to a more severe generalized form and characterized by weakness in the extremity or muscle that govern the basic life function, that means bulbar muscle and the respiratory muscles, including diaphragm. So the clinical manifestation of myasthenia gravis are divided into two forms, basically ophthalmic and extra-ophthalmic, that we have already discussed in the last slide. The ophthalmic include eyelid dysfunction, mainly ptosis due to weakness of LPS, and upper eyelid retraction and lid twitching, whereas extraocular muscle involvement results in the diplopia and blurred vision. So we'll discuss this in detail later on. Whereas the extra-ophthalmic manifestation include bulbar palsy that results in dysphagia, difficulty in mastication, then choking, dystonia, difficulty in and change in the voice. So these are this happen due to laryngopharyngeal and the muscle of mastication involvement. So that part is known as bulbar palsy. Then weakness of facial muscle results in the small smile. That is, while generally we try to smile, there will be the equivalent vertical and horizontal widening of this lip area. But in those patients, there will be vertical enlargement, but not the horizontal due to weakness of zygomaticus. So there will be small smile that I will show in later on. Another is worried face appearance will be there in the later stage. Then another is limb girdle weakness. Generally, proximal muscle
we apologize for a small technical issue here. Just give us some seconds. So we'll just be back. So you can please start the session from wherever you have left. You can please start the session once again, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
You can share the screen now.
Hello.
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you.
Hello.
Start.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Sorry for this disturbance. Okay.
No problems. You can go ahead with the session, sir.
Okay, so we have already talked about the manifestation, this ophthalmic and extraophthalmic. Now the association that this disorder commonly associated with that of these are the disorder, these 8-9 disorder which we can get in this patient. Most common feature is thymic. Dangerous thing is the tumor that is thymoma and the thymic atrophy. These are the three thymus disorder which we can see in this patient. Thymic follicular hyperplasia is detectable in almost 70 to 80% of case, while thymoma in 10% of case, and the thymic atrophy can be seen in 10 to 20% of cases. And another commonly missed association is hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism, mostly hypothyroidism. So in this patient, we should always do a thyroid function test once we detect the myasthenia gravis. Other being the rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes mellitus, SLE, Jorgen syndrome, and polymyositis, which are not much common, but sometimes they can be there. So we should investigate if we don't get any other association. So in this, they have staged this disorder into four form. Those are ocular form, which we will be discussing again, and generalized form that can be in stage two is mild to moderately severe. Third is acute fulminant, and last one is the severe late. I have told you this small face. There is no widening on horizontal plane, but if you see in the as the disappearance, which you can see this. In this case also. So coming to the ocular myasthenia gravis, it is a subtype of myasthenia gravis where muscle weakness is confined to eye. Eye means there are three sets of muscle, including extraocular muscle, levator palpebrae superioris muscle, which is the retractor of upper eyelid, and the orbicularis oculi muscle, which is the muscle that close your eye. So if ocular myasthenia gravis is limited to these three muscles, then that is the ocular myasthenia gravis. It typically progresses to generalized after a few years. I have written over there, that is almost 80 to 90% of them progress to the generalized myasthenia gravis by 2 years. Some of the authors are writing like that. So almost half to two-thirds of myasthenia gravis present in ocular form. Thus, initial presentation of myasthenia is ocular. That's why we need to alert. We people should know about this disorder, because almost half to two-thirds of them present to us at first of their clinical visit. So 1/10 of the case, the illness remain restricted to the ocular muscle throughout their life. So 10% of them do not progress to the generalized form. So they do not need to meet other specialty if we treat them nicely. So these are the two facts why we need to know about the ocular myasthenia gravis. Why this disease present to us or present more in the ocular muscle? There are two reasons. Ocular muscles are very small in size, so they will tired earlier. So the mild form of disease also can attack this muscle. 80% of the muscle fiber are single innervated twitch fiber. So single muscle fiber having single nerve, so there will be high nerve firing frequency in that muscle, and that will tired earlier, so they will be affected earlier. Another thing is, if minimal involvement of ocular muscle, there will be symptom, not in the limb muscle, bulbar muscle, and respiratory muscle. They need much more severely involvement to manifest as a symptom. So what are the symptoms that easily occur in those scenario is, in extraocular movement, there will be diplopia. In case of involvement of LPS, there will be ptosis. So these are the things we should know in our session. So here, due to variable involvement of different extraocular muscle, motility pattern are not characteristic of lesion of one or more nerve. If we know the nerve supply of extraocular muscle, superior oblique is supplied by trochlear nerve. Other are supplied. Lateral rectus is Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible. Please.
I'm audible. Okay. So, due to variable involvement of different, due to variable involvement of in different extraocular muscle, motility pattern are not characteristic of a nerve lesion. That I have told you, that is due to, all of you know, superior oblique is supplied by trochlear, lateral rectus is supplied by sixth nerve, that is abducens, and rest of all are supplied by oculomotor nerve. But if there is paralysis of sixth nerve, there will be limitation in lateral movement. If there is paralysis of another nerve, there will be characteristic pattern. But in this case, there will be paralysis of restriction of extraocular muscle, but which is not specific to any of this particular nerve. So if there is incommittent squint with not characteristic lesion of any nerve, then we have to think of this disorder. Another thing is, ptosis and diplopia are the initial sign in most of the myasthenia gravis patient, and 50 to 80% of them develop generalized disease, as I have already told you. 90% of them develop within 2 years after the ocular symptom begins. Means most of them develop generalized form within 2 years of symptom. So then, going in detail about the eyelid manifestation, first important feature was the variable ptosis. Means ptosis, sometime more severe ptosis, sometime moderate, sometime no ptosis. This is the ptosis, variable ptosis, which is the most common manifestation. It start with upper lid, start with unilateral, and later become the bilateral. Can or may not. So asymmetric variable ptosis having typical history of ptosis absent on awakening and appear over a period and maximum at the evening time. So this is the typical history that you get in the variable ptosis. Another thing is lethargy test. Ptosis may increase after prolonged upgrade, which you can test on your clinic. Peaks and gradual appearance of lag of thalamus during gentle eyelid closure. That is due to orbicularis oculi muscle involvement. And Kogan-Leet twitch, you can see a quick overshooting upward movement followed by a down drift of the upper lid after the patient perform a saccade back to primary position for looking down for at least 15 seconds. This sign is not specific but very useful clinical test. In bilateral case, when ptosis ptotic eyelid lifted manually, there will be enhancements of ptosis of the contralateral eyelid. If you lift the your ptotic lid, there will be ptosis in the opposite lid due to Hering's law of equivalent innervation, that LPS is supplied by both third nerve. So if you lift the right ptotic eyelid, there will be more innervation going to the that lid, and there will be less innervation will go to the contralateral lid, resulting in the more ptosis in the that eye. Then upper lid retraction is the another sign. So these are the thing: upper lid eyelid retraction and contralateral to the ptotic upper eyelid. So you can see in this figure, the left eye is a ptotic eye. Left eye is the ptotic eye, and the right eye there is the retraction of upper lid. Vishnu, it is working. Hello.
Okay. Yes, sir. We are able to hear you.
Okay. So ptosis in left eye, but if you see clearly, there is clear also in the upper side. So there is lid retraction in the right, which sometimes due to concurrent thyroid eye disease. So these are the thing that though we think of this disease. So secondly, extra muscle involvement is the second medial rectus. So no specific it is the muscle disorders to superior rectus muscle involvement. Diplopia is usually seen in with ptosis, but may be present as an isolated finding as well. Generally in clinic, what we see is most of the patient present to us with ptosis, and they may have simultaneous diplopia. But isolated diplopia is also possible in this disorder. So what is needed to know is ocular myasthenia gravis can mimic any comitant and incomitant squint, ranging from nerve palsy, gaze palsy, unilateral or bilateral eye anus. So you should just know in this fact is that myasthenia can mimic any incomitant spoon, paralytic type spoon, and sometime maybe of comitant type also, but mostly you should know here is it can mimic any incomitant spoon. Then it can mimic any pupil sparing ocular motor motility disorder. Same what I am telling over here, it does not involve pupil. There will not be pupillary muscle paralysis. Why? Over here, if you know the definition, it is the disorder of NMJ of skeletal muscle, not of the smooth muscle and cardiac muscle. I have told at the definition point. So, these sphincter pupillae and dilator pupillae, both of them are smooth muscle rather than a skeletal muscle. So, pupil will not be affected in this disorder. That is the important finding along with these three things, eyelid ptosis, eyelid retraction, and diplopia. If there is no pupillary involvement, then we have to thought of this disorder. Ophthalmoplegia vary from mild paresis of a single muscle to the complete ophthalmoplegia, frozen eye up to. So this is the thing. So clinically, ocular myasthenia gravis should be suspected in any variable incomitant squint with or without ptosis. So variable squint, variable ptosis of incomitant type, not equal in every gait. So squint is changing in different gaits, just like that of paralytic, but not may be associated or not with ptosis. So in such case, we should think of this ocular myasthenia gravis. This saccade, also there will be decline in the saccadic velocity after multiple attempt. Generally, nystagmus is not a feature of this disorder, but sometime there are reports, they have observed it, but it's doubtful. But another important finding you should see in these cases, normal pupil, normally reacting pupil, then this is the thing. What are the diagnostic clinical tests? There are two clinical tests that I have to tell you. One is the sleep test, another is the ice pack test. This one is the ice pack and this is the sleep test. So these are the very, very important clinical tests in cases of ocular motility disorder and of this ptosis. The sleep test principle is that there is improvement in the manifestation of ocular myasthenia after a period of rest. That we have talked earlier. After a period of rest, there is supposed to be increase in the level of acetylcholine in the neuromuscular junction. Is we don't need to have contractile muscle during that time. Our muscles are relaxed at that time. Once you awake from that sleep, there will be slightly more amount of acetylcholine, and this lead to the more action potential generation over there due to their higher concentration, and there will be this improvement in the motility. So for which we need to do the ocular motility deficit and ptosis finding before the test. We have document these in the paper. Then we allow the patient to sleep or rest with closed eye for 30 minutes in a dark room. Then if after 30 minutes, we should immediately check our motility deficit and the ptosis. If there is immediate improvement, that is regarded as a test positive, and reappearance of the myasthenic sign over the next 30 seconds to 5 minutes it's further confirmation. So another is reappearance of myasthenic sign after 30 seconds to 5 minutes of observation confirm the this ocular myasthenia. Another important clinical test which we must know, all of us must know, is this ice pack test. This what is the principle over here is pulling reduce the acetyl esterase is a acetylcholine esterase is a enzyme that degrade the acetylcholine enzymatically in the neuromuscular. So its activity is reduced, then that acetylcholine will remain for longer duration in the neuromuscular junction, in the persistent pooling reduces activity, and so there will be increasing amount of acetylcholine at the neuromuscular junction. How patients close 2 minutes in patient with ptosis only and 4-5 minutes in patient with extraocular muscle. In similar way, we will be measuring the ocular motility deficit and ptosis before and after the test. Eyelid elevation by more than 2 mm generally, though this is not a consensus, but it's the general form. What is the difficulty in this? You put it more than 2 minutes due to cooling effect. It's difficult to put for longer duration. That is the one negative thing. And if you overcool, there will be the false negative of the muscle fiber. So this test is very, very sensitive test, having more than 90% of ocular myasthenia patient ptosis improve after the test. So myasthenia improve with this test, and so it is very, very ideal test for ocular myasthenia with ptosis. It has the sensitivity of around 98%. Combination of sleep test and ice pack test increase the sensitivity of this test. Other tests include the electrophysiological test, which are not commonly done. And you can see repetitive nerve stimulation test, in which there will be detrimental after 4th and 5th, there will be progressive decremental response by the muscle on repeated nerve stimulation test. The first response is high amplitude, whereas later on there will be a decreasing manner. Another test is the single fiber electromyography. Here also neuromuscular jitter will be seen, which were of also similarly decreasing value. Then this is the another test which generally been done in the setting when we are not relying on the clinical test, when we have doubt on the ice pack and the result of this sleep test, then we should do this test. Generally, in my experience, what we do is when there is doubt, even after the test and equivocal test, then we do this test. Hydrophonium test is the ideal because it's very rapidly acting drug. Mechanism is, you know, this is the acetylcholine esterase inhibitor. So it will also act in the similar way of that of ISPAC test, and by increasing the acetylcholine availability at the neuromuscular junction. So main thing is it act within 30 to 60 seconds and resolve by 5 to 10 minutes. So there will be less side effect and rapidly you can see the result on your test. But the very bad thing about this is very costly and not available in India anymore. So that is the bad thing with this test. Another thing we need to know is that it has the very, very bad side to keep atropine ready, and we should do continuous monitoring of blood pressure, pulse, and ECG. So it is contraindicated in, it has 86% of sensitivity in ocular myasthenia gravis. What we do in our setup in India and Nepal is neostigmine 1.5 mg vial. So in this test, the disadvantages over hydrophonium or tensilone is that it is longer acting, so side effect profile is more than that of hydrophonium. But advantage of this test is that due to its longer duration of action, it make it more suited for the detailed and prolonged examination of ocular motility and diplopia testing. So we generally need to inject atropine. In hydrophonium, we keep it ready. If there is side effect, then we inject. But in this case, we inject atropine to prevent its muscarinic side effect, as it is the antidote of neostigmine. Then only we inject 1.5 mg of this injection into the muscle. Then we have already measured all the ocular motility finding and the ptosis finding, mainly the pulse, pebral, fisserite, or marginal reflex distance 1 and the extraocular movement. And then once we injected, we observed the patient for 10 to 15 minutes, and thereafter we examine once, and then every 15 to 30 minutes we do this again and again till the 2 to 3 hours. If the test is negative, even after 2 to 3 hours, then we declare it as a negative result. Then these are the immunological testing. Anti-acetylcholine receptor antibody estimation. It is a serological test. So the basic pathology is that in this disorder, there will be elevated acetylcholine receptor antibody, confirm the diagnosis of myasthenia gravis. So ideally, if we have the facility, we should do this test in all cases of ocular myasthenia. Secondly, and response to our immunomodulatory therapy. So once, if we give immunomodulatory therapy, it will help us in the long-term setup. In Nepal, we don't have this, but India, we have. Anti-mosque test is another test. Um, if this myasthenia is almost most of the thymoma case, there will be positive anti-MOX case. Then one imaging that you should do always is CT chest to detect the thymoma or thymic hyperplasia. If we detect this, this is the one disorder. If we remove that, almost 30% of them get remission, and that means the myasthenia will be go from patient's body throughout the life. So this is the only treatment of myasthenia that can remove or benefit patient for lifelong is by the thymectomy. So we need to do this to detect whether there is thymus disorder or not. You can see in this photo, there is the anterior mass anterior to this large blood vessel in the upper chest. So this is the thymic hyperplasia or thymoma, same in the this photo. In this X-ray, here is that thymoma. But X-ray has very, very less sensitivity, so it is not the ideal imaging. Other tests, thyroid function test, I have highlighted 4 to 10% of them has the thyroid deficit. All the management are of three types. First one is the symptomatic management, because patient become disabled, so we need to manage them with symptomatic therapy. Then disease modifying therapy can be medical or surgical. So that is to modify the progression of the disease, not to or halt the progression of disease. And the another is the treatment of associated disorder that we have already listed 8, 9 over there. So symptom management of ocular myasthenia gravis. The treatment of this is acetylcholine esterase inhibitor. That is the enzyme inhibitor, which only improve the muscle weakness. This is the term we should tell to the patient before starting treatment. This will only improve the weakness of muscle. It is not going to improve your disease progression. So disease can progress, but you will have only the improvement in the muscle weakness. So the agent that we are using are oral pyridostigmine, available in the form of Gravitor, myostigmine, and neostigmine, which is also oral agent, that is available in the form of telestigmine over here. So they will improve the level improve the neuromuscular junction. Then the disease modifying therapy include medical treatment. These are the four medical thing that are there for the disease modifying therapy. First one is corticosteroid, as it is an autoimmune disease. Corticosteroid will improve health in the improvement of the disease. Prednisolone is the drug that we are giving, but the thing that you should remember over here is it should be started in very low dose. What we do is 10 mg alternate day starting dose. Then if patient is improving, we do not increase the dose. If not improving, then we can add this dose. But some of the patient are irresponsive to this this steroid, then cyclosporine A and mycophenolate mofetil. Plasma exchange has been also useful, in these severe cases, but ocular myasthenia, they generally don't become so serious and we are not doing this. Then you can see the thymus in this trachea and this big vessel. Surgical therapy for this is the thymectomy. I have already documented thymic enlargement on the CT scan. That is thymic hyperplasia or the thymoma. And the patient younger than 60 years. It's generally not the doing surgery of no means. So generally it should be done in the case who present below 60 years. Clinical improvement occurs in 70 to 80% of patients, whereas 30 to 35% of patients reach complete remission. That is the only way of remission. This disease modifying therapy and symptomatic therapy never remit the disease. So this much of part of the thymus is removed in this therapy, but need the chest surgeon. So in ocular myasthenia, if ptosis is the only manifestation, only over here, what is the thing is, if there is ptosis is the only manifestation, you don't study. If ptosis is not improved after many episodes of long treatment with acetylcholine esterase inhibitor, then difficulty to carry out the active all therapy, then you can go for surgery, that is generally slingshot there. Then symptomatic should be avoided with the disease modifying therapy. Mostly we start prednisolone in 10 mg alternate day dose. Then thymectomy is generally not indicated, but if there is obvious generalized form and there is obvious enlargement of this thymus in CT scan, then you can do this. This is the another important slide that I must stress you people. Drug that should not be given to the patient of ocular myasthenia, if they are given to this patient, they will lead to the myasthenic crisis and that can take the life of this patient. So this is the only thing that you should able to remember even after this lecture. Aminoglycoside, gentamicin group, streptomycin group, tobramycin, these drugs should not be given. Beta blocker, we are giving timolol. This drug should be avoided in this patient. Amlodipine is a drug of choice for hypertensive, but it should not be given in these cases. Succinylcholine is a drug of choice for the general anesthesia, initiation of general anesthesia. That should be avoided, but this is the thing to be known by anesthesis than that of us. And then quinine, these are the drug of heart and that of malaria. These are also not suitable for this patient and generally not even used in this time. Then magnesium, which is the treatment of eclampsia. If the patient of myasthenia develops eclampsia, if we inject magnesium, that will take our life. So it should not be given in those cases. An antacid containing magnesium should be not used, should not be used. Laxative having magnesium should not be used. These are the common drugs, so we should know these things. Magnesium, antacid, and laxative are not drug to be used in myasthenic patient. Penicillamine also should not be used. Iodinated contrast agent are also not useful, which are used generally in the this disease of kidney during IBU. So these are the thing. This is the table and the drug that you should know. These are not suitable for this patient. So this is the simple table where we have they have given the management of this myasthenic gravis. We only focus on first one, ocular myasthenia. Check MRI. Better I tell you is check CT and then acid anticholine storage. That is symptomatic therapy, including this. We are telling you stigmine are the treatment. If the treatment is unsatisfactory, then you can do the startle of the prednisolone and immunosuppression. That is the thing in this part, ocular. Rest, we are not much bothered. So these are the crises, myasthenic crisis, cholinergic crisis that can take the life of the patient. So you can go through this thing also, but it's not commonly seen in our patient. I will be showing you this case that I have managed at this hospital, Nepalganj Medical College. Though unusual case, I will be showing only this case. That is a 13-year male from Banke, presented with drooping of left eyelid for 15 days, which was painless and on and off. His mother says it was more noticeable when he returns from the school. There was no history of distracting, no history of similar illness in the family, no history of ocular trauma, no any developmental disorder and use of any drug and ETI. After this history of on and off ptosis, history of acquired ptosis, generally it rule out the neurologic and this aponeurotic ptosis, also the congenital ptosis. So that take our intention for the examination towards the this illness. Another thing is that this was more noticeable at the when he returns from the school, means after the prolonged walk, it is worsening. So that's why we think of this disorder as a differential. Another finding that we can see in the contralateral eye, there is complete upper lip retraction, which is the another important finding. Disorder due to weakness of orbicularis ocula. At that point, we keep that as a differential. So at this point, would you do ptosis surgery? No, we need further evaluation because we think of it is not of a normal ptosis case of congenital type, aponeurotic type. So we have to investigate for other things. With surgery, we are not choosing surgery. Later, if needed, sealing can be done. And why? Because it has variable course, so surgery may lead to the disaster. So we do the ice pack test on our clinic. There was improvement in left eye after the 2-minute ice pack test. So that is the positive result with that test. As the ISPAC test is positive, we don't take patient for risk of neostigmine. Thyroid function was done as the eyelid retraction. You can see retraction. You can see in the right eye, but it was normal. CT test revealed thymic lymphoid follicular hyperplasia. These antibody and physiological tests are not available here, and neostigmine test we prevent because ISPAC give the positive result. So what we investigate is only one thyroid function test and second is the CT test. Rest we don't do. After all, as the patient don't have generalized ocular myasthenia and it's only ocular, and another finding is that there is no involvement of extraocular muscle, we choose the symptomatic therapy. We started with pyridostigmine tablet 30 mg at 9 a.m. and 3 to 4 p.m. for 15 days, rupees per tablet. So patient belongs to a poor family, so they could not afford for long duration. That's why compliance is another thing that we need to know. We give the tilistigmine, that is neostigmine, 15 mg at 9 a.m. and at 3 to 4 p.m. After that, he was continuously using that tablet, and patient at the 30th day, you can see right eyelid retraction is also gone. And there is relatively normal, much more improvement in left eye ptosis, not up to normal, but it's relatively normal. And there are no any symptom at the 1 year, but sometimes when he was telling to me that when they have not available medicine and they miss the dose, sometimes they 1 to 2 times they have missed for 15-20 days. During that time, he again have this problem. So after that, we have again restarted, and now he is enjoying his school life without any difficulty, but he is regularly taking this medication. So at the end of this presentation, what I expect is, in case of variable ptosis, variable incomitant squint with a normal pupil, three things are there: variable ptosis, variable incomitant squint, and the normal pupil. Always think of ocular myasthenia. All ISPAC test is sufficient and very, very effective test. So we should do in all case of ptosis and ocular motility disorder to rule out this great mimicker. Ocular myasthenia gravis is now treatable illness. With treatment, they can live normal life and have normal without ruling myasthenia gravis can be a disaster. Thank you all. Hello.
Okay, sir. There is question from Ankita Mishra asks, do dietary factor play important role in measurement of...
I am audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. So sir, question from Ankita Mishra. Okay. He asks, do dietary factor play role in management of myasthenia gravis? If yes, what type of food should we recommend?
Okay.
Hello?
Hello, sir? Sad. My network problem or something. Yes, it's audible. Can you repeat
that
question?
Can you read the question in the chat box, sir? We have entered the question in the chat box.
Sir, from question from Ankita Mishra.
Yes.
He asks, do dietary factor play a role in management of myasthenia gravis? If yes, what type of food should we recommend?
Yes, Bisnu.
Yes, sir.
It's not.
I'm audible there. Hello.
Yeah. Now you are audible, but it's going and something disturbing.
Yes, sir. Question from Ankita Mishra, sir. She asked.
Bisnu?
Yes, sir. Hello.
Oh God. In chat box, yeah. Tell me. You are now nicely audible. Yeah.
Question from Ankita Mishra, sir. She asks, do dietary factor play a role in management of myasthenia gravis? If yes, what type of food should we recommend?
Dietary thing. Okay, regarding diet. Regarding diet, I have not gone any specific type of diet we should take or we should not take. But the thing is that those things that results in the calcium in some should be prevented. But really, it's not a specific type of food you should take. Salt should be restricted. Salt should not be much.
Okay, sir. Another question, sir, from Manish Chaudhary. What should be the most important initial investigation on suspected myasthenia gravis?
I can see now the chat box. Manish, the most important on myasthenia gravis. Yeah. I can see his question. I can see it. Okay. Manish, Bisnu.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. I'm audible there.
Am I audible? Yeah. So I have seen here that question of Manish Chaudhary.
Yes,
so
sir.
So most important initial investigation on the suspected case of myasthenia. Clinical test, you know the that sleep test and the another this ice pack test. These are the very, very important tests that can be done on our clinic. But the investigation, most important investigation is the confirmation of the diagnosis, that is estimation of acetylcholine receptor antibody. That is the most important investigation. Another most important should not be missed one is the chest imaging. So is the almost 30% of case remit after the thymectomy. So these two are the important investigation. One is the acetylcholine receptor antibody estimation. Another is the chest CT to detect the thymic hyperplasia or thymoma.
Another question, sir. From Dr. Dawal Bahadur Dhami.
Yeah.
Sir,
I can see that also.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Regarding his question, Dr. Has very good question over here. I will prefer hydroponium because it is less toxic. And it is less, it does not last more. So better is hydroponium obviously, but advantage of neostigmine over this is, we can do SS diplopia cases with, in detail, it response lasts for longer duration. So best is hydrophonium if we have, but it's not available in India and Nepal. That's why we are doing neostimming. But best is hydrophonium. Mm-hmm. I can see Anup Sugedi's question, which test is more effective, sleep test or ice pack to diagnose at the primary year? I think ice pack is better because my teacher, Dr. Mahesh Kumar, was always doing this ice pack test. I have not much experience with sleep test because it has many defaults. So ice pack is better if you do properly and if you have that facility of keeping ice pack in a fridge in your clinic. But if you don't have fridge, then you have only option that is sleep test. And am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, you are audible.
Vishnu?
Yes, sir. You are audible. Another question, sir, from Anup Subedi.
Then I can see another question from Dr. Dami. And why? Yeah, it is also a very, very important question and always and with less side effect. Okay, the incidence of side effect, this allergic side effect with pyridine. These drugs are available in the market of India, but not in Nepalganj area, but it may be available in Kathmandu. The major fact over here that I faced for my two of my patients is that pyridostigmine is slightly expensive. A single dose of this cost around 25 to 30 rupees. So, per day of patient has to expense around 60 to 80 rupees for the treatment of this disease. While neostigmine is having more side effect, but it has less costing around 5 rupees per tablet. That means within 10 rupees, we can treat this patient. If they can afford, I will go for pyridostigmine. We should also see the socioeconomic status of our patient. So if they cannot afford and they are not compliant due to this drug, we can choose neostigmine as I have chosen in this patient. After I give the neostigmine, clear time when I gave him pyridostigmine, he has lost its compliance many times. So despite of being best drug is pyridostigmine, I have given another one. Are there any more questions? Is there any more question, Vishnu?
Yes, sir. Last question. There is any difference between ocular myasthenia gravis and ocular myasthenia gravis and myasthenia gravis?
Hello? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Hello.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, you are audible.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes. Okay. Sorry for this net. Okay. I'll... explaining this, okay. Myasthenia gravis and ocular myasthenia gravis. I have already been told you that ocular myasthenia gravis is a subset of myasthenia gravis. All ocular myasthenia gravis are myasthenia gravis, but all myasthenia gravis may not be the ocular myasthenia gravis. One is that thing we should know. So ocular myasthenia is a subset of myasthenia gravis. Pathophysiology is same, but the manifestation is different. That is, throughout the life, ocular myasthenia may restrict to the three muscle of the eye. Those are LPS, levator palpebrae superioris, orbicularis oculi, and the extraocular muscle. But myasthenia can involve all of those bulbar muscle, ocular muscle, respiratory muscle, neck muscle, and the extremity limb muscle. So in that these are different. Secondly, also on examination and investigation, there are many differences, but not, these are the I have elaborated in the presentation also.
Okay, thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. Hello, I'm audible there. Hello.
Thank you so much, Vishnu, but sorry for that.
Okay, sir.
It does not open properly.
Okay, thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. On behalf of Optum, I thank you and all our audience for attending this e-learning session. Stay tuned for more session in future.
So much, guys. Thank you so much.